There's also the impulse function, which has a rather strange definition. So the impulse function is always zero except for one special time, which is it's going to be infinite at time equal to zero. So the plot of it looks like this, where you have this spike up here, and otherwise the function is just zero. We use an arrow because it's hard to draw actual infinity. So the arrow means we're headed towards infinity. And then also, I'm going to draw this arrow at a height of 1, meaning we have 1 infinity here. There are a couple other things to know about the impulse function. One is that it has, by definition, an integral equal to 1. This definition that you see here tells you about what its overall value is, but it doesn't necessarily tell you what the integral should be. But when you integrate this function over all time, the idea is that the area under this infinitely high curve that's going to be also infinitely short is just going to be defined to be equal to 1. There's another property of the impulse function that we call the sifting property, and the sifting property is described like this. You have an impulse function. It's been shifted in time by some amount. In this case, when you shift t minus t0, that's the same thing as taking the impulse and shifting it to the right by some amount t0. If you have this impulse and you multiply it by any function f of t, and then you multiply these together, you integrate them, and what you end up with is just f of t evaluated at time equal to zero. And I'm just going to quickly draw what that idea is. So we could start with some generic function f of t, and it has any shape that you like. We're going to multiply that by delta shifted by an amount t0. And actually, why don't I give that a different color? So here's a delta occurring at time 0. That's what delta of t minus t0 means. So if you multiply these functions together, what you can imagine is that the result is going to be something that's going to be 0 for all time. So I'm going to graph this in red, just so you know. It's going to be 0 for all time, except for one blip, which is going to occur at time t0. And this blip is an arrow that's been multiplied by the value of f at that time. So what's the value of f at that time? Well, let's pretend t0 is right here. There's f of t0. That's just been multiplied by our arrow here. And then we're saying that if you take this whole thing and you integrate it over time, that you're going to just get the area under this curve, and you're just going to get f of t0. This sifting property is a very strange-sounding property, but it actually ends up being extremely useful, and it's the basis for a lot of what we know about how systems behave. Here are some examples working with the sifting property of the unit impulse function. We're going to do three examples. So the first one, we have an f of t, which is just the cosine, and then the delta in this case has been shifted by an amount 0. So we just have to take cosine of 25t and evaluate it at the time t0, which in this case is equal to 0. So we end up with cosine of 0 is equal to 1. In the second example, we have our f of t again, e to the negative 4 times t minus 1. And then our unit impulse function has actually been shifted to the right by 2. And so we evaluate it t equals 2. So we end up with e to the minus 4 times t is equal to 2 minus 1. And so we end up with e to the minus 4. In our last example, we actually are shifting to the left, And what we end up with is 1 of t minus 3. That's a unit step function starting at time 3. And then we're going to evaluate it at t is equal to minus 4. Now, this function, if you recall, actually I'll try to sketch it quickly. 1 of t minus 3 just looks like this. It's going to have a value of 1 starting at time 3. So that's 1 of t minus 3. And of course, if you evaluate this at time t equals minus 4, it's just going to be equal to 0. So those are three examples of the sifting property of the unit impulse function.